Hello everyone, and welcome again to Nettle, the best platform around for distance learning in business, finance, economics, and much, much more. My name is Sava, and today we are continuing our wide range of videos on stock return modeling using tools of mathematical statistics. And today we are discussing the logistic distribution, one of the simplest distribution functions that one can imagine, and a very intuitive one to grasp. However, it is sometimes unjustly forgotten when we discuss stock return modeling. So we've got our usual setup. We've got 5 years worth of stock returns. We have ranked them previously, computed the empirical cumulative distribution function and compared it with the normal cumulative distribution function and saw that the fit is far from desirable. So we have already discussed loads of various alternative specifications one can use, such as the hypersecond distribution, the Laplace distribution, the Cauchy distribution, and the generalized normal distribution or error distribution. And logistic distribution is a good next step in this journey. Well, if you remember the logic of distribution functions is very simple. And you can design your own distribution function using your own intuition of mathematics, arithmetic, and functional analysis. So the main requirement that a distribution function must satisfy is that it should be bound between 0 and 1 throughout the domain of definition, because it must be interpretable as the probability that a random variable that abides by this distribution law does not exceed the particular value that you plug into this function. And that's why, as x tends to infinity, in most of those cases, the value of the distribution function must tend to 1. The logistic distribution utilizes this logic quite nicely, in my opinion. Well, it's just a ratio of 1 in the numerator, as simple as that, and 1 plus the exponent of minus scaled x. And this procedure of scaling x by subtracting the mean or median, in that case it's the mean, and dividing it by some scale parameter, you all remember that in case of normal distribution and hypersecond distribution, that was just simple standard deviation. However, here it's a uniquely defined scale parameter a. So what happens here? Well, as a is positive and the mean is just, well-known mean, we all are familiar with it. As x tends to infinity, then this whole ratio tends to infinity. And if we take the negative of it, it will tend to minus infinity. As we all know, the exponent of minus infinity tends to 0. The whole denominator tends to 1, because 1 plus 0 is 1. And then the whole fraction is 1 divided by 1 equals 1. So the value of the distribution function as x approaches infinity tends to 1. So the probability that something does not exceed something close to infinity is 1, which is very intuitive and very fitting for our purposes. Well, what happens if x approaches negative infinity? Well, then this fraction will approach negative infinity as well, and the negative of it will approach positive infinity. The exponent of positive infinity is positive infinity still, and then we'll have 1 divided by something that tends to positive infinity, so we'll have something that tends at the limit to 0. So if x is very, very small, the probability that a random variable that abides by this distribution law does not exceed it is very small, tends to 0. So the logic is fulfilled. That's the concept of logistic distribution. So how one might estimate this distribution, the parameters? Well, the mu can be just estimated as the mean, so average, and we already have it. We used it to estimate the normal cumulative distribution function. But how to estimate a? Well, turns out that there is a neat formula that relates a to sample variance. Variance is equal to a squared times pi squared divided by 3. So just doing some arithmetic rearrangements, one can figure out that A is equal to sample standard deviation times square root of 3 divided by pi. And what is, at the same time, kind of nice about the logistic distribution, but also is a major limitation, is that the curtices of the logistic distribution is always equal to 6/5, so 1.2. It means that the logistic distribution has slightly heavier tails than the normal distribution with famous axis curtices of 0, but slightly thinner tails than either the hypersecond distribution with axis curtices of 2, and thinner tails still than the Laplace distribution with the axis curtices of 3. So logistic distribution is not as flexible as something like the generalized normal distribution, where you can get any value of curtices as you like by just meddling with the distribution parameters. A good thing is that the logistic distribution is very easy to derive and very easy to calibrate by just using the sample standard deviation. That's what we're going to do right now and see how well does it fit the S&P 500 returns. So we just need to take the sample standard deviation, multiply it by the square root of 3 and divide it by pi. And again, to get pi in Excel, you need to code it as a function. So pi and empty parentheses so that it treats it as a function. So we see that the scale parameter is 0.47%. And now we have everything we need to actually generate the cumulative distribution function for the logistic distribution. So translating this logic into the language of Excel formulas, we can have 1 divided by 1 plus the exponent of minus ranked return, which is our x observable variable, minus the sample mean, and we log the row as we don't want it to change, divided by our scale parameter, so A, which is 0.47%, we've just calculated it. And we lock the row here as well. And that's the whole cumulative distribution function. It's really simple and does not depend on many parameters. So bottom right click it all the way down, we can see that, well, it kinda underestimates how fat the actual tails are, as you can see. On the right-hand side, pretty much the same thing happens, albeit to a lesser extent. If we look at it graphically, we can see that the logistic distribution does get a slightly better fit than the normal distribution, but still is way far off, especially at the tails. So probably an axis curtices of 6/5 or 1.2 is a major understatement of the actual axis curtices of the distribution. And, well, we know it, because from past examples, we discussed that the axis curtices is 3.83, or something like that. Well, logistic distribution is nevertheless is really useful, and you can use it for stock return modeling when your sample curtices is close to 6/5. Or you always can apply a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test or Anderson-Dahlin test and see which of the distributions that you consider is indeed the best fit using a rigorous mathematical statistics procedure. In the next video, we will discuss another distribution that will allow you to get any value of curtices you want and mimic your empirically observed sample curtices. Please leave a like under this video if you found it helpful. In the comments below, please leave any suggestions on further topics in business economics or finance that you want me to investigate in future videos. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Thank you very much and stay tuned.